A2PC. Today we've got section 2.6, our penultimate section for chapter 2. And actually this section, I really could combine it with the next one, 2.7. So this section is going to stand to do a lot of the legwork that will go into chapter 7. We're talking about rational functions today and the asymptotes that the graphs have. And what this will allow us to do is ultimately in 2.7, we're going to generate graphs. But here we're just kind of looking at some of their qualities. So knowing what these functions have in them is very helpful when we graph. You'll notice a lot of similarities between section 2.6 and 2.7. The little play on words today is on the word asymptote. So here we've got an asymptotum pole. and this is kind of what our graphs will be doing to some extent. You'll notice that they kind of approach this asymptote line and they get pulled closer and closer to it in the long run. Now, the downside to this is, why it's its own section, is because there's a lot of things happening here. So let's just kind of break down the textbook jargon here and kind of learn how to pick apart these types of functions. And then I think we'll be able to find the patterns in there. It's actually very fast work once we know how to read these. So they give us an example of something that looks really intimidating. So they're saying, let some function equal a numerator function over a denominator function, where the numerator is some polynomial and so is the denominator. Okay, so we're looking at, for rational functions, a polynomial over another polynomial. And they use some fancy language here like a sub n. That's just saying our first coefficient on x to the nth power. And then a to the n minus 1 means the next coefficient with the next lowest power and so on until we get to a coefficient on a first power and a constant at the end. So it's just their fancy way of saying a polynomial that has any coefficient and it could have any degree. But it's written in standard form. I think that's important that we have the highest powered terms listed first. Same thing is true with the denominator. They just use different variables since it's its own function down there. So they use m's and b's instead of a's and n's. All right, so the first thing that we want to do is we want to look for holes in the graph. Whenever n of x and d of x have common factors that cancel out, these types of functions, if we think of like an x squared plus 3x minus 7 over x squared minus 4, there's a tendency here to kill puppies and think that those cancel out, but they do not. We can only cancel once things have been factored. Cancel factors, not terms. So have common factors that cancel. So let's imagine that our function f of x, we factor out the numerator and get like a 2x plus 3 times x minus 4. We factor out our denominator and we get an x minus 4 times an x minus 3. Notice how multiplied into the top and the bottom was a factor of x minus 4. That tells us there's a hole in the graph when x equals positive 4, the solution coming out of those factors. Okay? So our first job, if we wanted to put it into like layman's terms here, is going to be factor and cancel, if we can. We won't always be able to make a cancellation there, but we do definitely want to sink some time into factoring early. Okay, if we get a cancellation, then not only do we get the location of a hole in the graph, but we also find out that we get a simpler function coming out, because after I have canceled out that factor, now the f of x I have to work with in this example is 2x plus 3 over x minus 3, much simpler than whatever we would have started with. All right, a vertical asymptote in the graph, it's a line, it's an x equals line. And if we have our graph coming in from the left, it's going to race either up or down towards that line. And then from the right, it's going to race either up or down towards the line. That could go the same way, it could go the opposite way. But the idea is it's not connecting up with the other side, it's kind of racing up or down, assuming the form of that line. Now, they occur at the zeros of the denominator. And if you think about a vertical line, that's a line that has an undefined slope. So when you learned about that in Algebra 1, how do we have an undefined slope? It's if our rise over run was something like 4 over 0. The same thing's happening in a rational function. As our denominator becomes closer and closer to dividing by 0, the graph takes on a vertical appearance there. Okay, so vertical asymptotes, denominator equals 0 is the takeaway there. sorry, I should be emphasizing these. Factor and cancel, then look for denominator equaling zero. Horizontal asymptotes, we're just going to very casually refer to this as the big X test, and the more you can make sense of this type of thinking, the better off you're going to be. And I'm not talking about just in this class, but calculus as well, particularly Calc 2. So we're thinking way down the line. We're setting ourselves up really nicely here. But it's determined by the degrees of the numerator and the denominator. So let's imagine that we have an f of x that's like 5x to the 7th plus 2x to the 3rd plus 7x minus 1. And our denominator is 4x to the 3rd minus 2x plus 15. And I'm just making that up off the spot. But think of our sprinters, intermediates, distance runners. What's determining the end behavior? What happens when x gets really big positive or really big negative? It's those distance runners that are going to take over. So all the other work here essentially gets washed away. It's those distance runners we're evaluating for horizontal asymptotes. What's happening at the extreme ends? So we've kind of already talked about this a little bit, maybe ever so slightly. But if I look at just those distance runners, I can think of, just for horizontal asymptotes, hey, f of x is really 5x to the 7th over 4x to the 3rd. It's behaving a lot like 5/4 x to the 4th. It's going to rise and rise on the ends. All right, now for this section, we kind of keep things a little bit simpler than that, of course. If the numerator's degree is less than the denominator's degree, think about it, the denominator is taking over. If I had like an f of x, and let's say I do this like distance runner analysis, and I had like a 3x over a 5x to the 3rd, that's like 3 over 5. X to the second, but the x to the second's in the denominator. If x gets massively huge here, I've essentially got to think about typing in 3 divided by 50,000 in your calculator. It's going to be so close to zero when x gets huge. That's what's happening here. And it's probably the most common thing is that, well, I shouldn't say most common. It's pretty typical to see the denominator take over in terms of degree. So it's very common to see a y equals zero horizontal asymptote. Denominator taking over means that that fraction's approaching zero in the long run. The output of the function's approaching zero in the long run. If we have equal degrees, so again, imagine we're kind of doing this type of analysis that we did over here, and we come up with our distance runners being like a 7x to the 3rd over negative 5x to the 3rd. See how these are equally matched distance runners? Look at what that simplifies to. It's just a negative 7/5. When x gets massive, 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 these are going to kind of be keeping pace with each other really well, and it simplifies down to that line, and that's what that fraction represents here, the coefficient, leading coefficient of the numerator over leading coefficient of the denominator. So you could call that the no takeover, or equal power, I think, is a good one, because it shows that the degrees are matching perfectly there. Okay, and lastly, if the numerator has a higher degree, so again, thinking distance runner analysis here, if we end up with something like a 5x to the second power over a 2x, hey, with large x values, our function's simplifying to a, 5x over 2, that's a linear function. So that means that on the graph, the ends of the graph are going to be looking like a line. You know, there may be bending or vertical asymptotes or stuff happening in the middle, but the ends will be behaving like the line 5x over 2. So if we have a higher degree in the numerator, there's no horizontal asymptote. It's another function. To find that function specifically, we use long division, and we ignore the remainder. So this kind of big X test will give us an idea, but to find that specific asymptote line that's not horizontal, it may be that, or if we're, it is possible to have asymptotes that are like a parabola, which is really, really cool when you have functions that kind of behave this way. In the ends of the graph, kind of tend towards this parabola looking thing. All right, but again, to find the specifics for what function is defining this asymptote, we would use long division. That is an absolute load. So horizontal asymptotes, the big X test, we're looking for takeover in terms of degrees, but there's definitely some patterns here, and I think you'll find that with a few repetitions, you can find this stuff pretty quickly. All right, so our first problem set in the homework is going to be a matching section. I'm only having you do the odds, so I've grabbed just N even, and you've got the full gamut of all the graphs to choose from. What kind of things are we looking for here? So as I look at this, first of all, I cannot factor or cancel anything, so there's no holes in the graph. Looking at all these different graphs, if I know the vertical and horizontal asymptotes here, that would give me a pretty good idea. Okay, so vertical asymptotes happen when the denominator equals zero. So what would make 1 minus x equals zero? You may be able to do this in your head and say, hey, if x equals 1. So I'm looking for a graph that has a vertical asymptote where x equals 1. So here's a vertical asymptote in letter B, but it's happening at 1, 2, 3, 4. In letter A, we've got a vertical asymptote. I probably should have done that one first, but it appears to be where x equals negative 2. For letter C, my vertical asymptote is where x equals 0, because right on the y-axis is where it kind of zings off. The graph stops being smooth and races off towards vertical. At letter D, the vertical asymptote is happening where x equals 3, so it can't be that one. For letter E, my vertical asymptote appears to be x equals 0 yet again. Hold up. For my last one, I get 1, 2, 3, 4, x equals negative 4. I don't see a single graph there that has a vertical asymptote where x equals 1. Let me see. I may have only screen captured. this is embarrassing. But after looking at the textbook, I've copied the problem wrong. So I flipped the fraction when I typed it in. The actual f of x is equal to 1 minus x over x. And so our vertical asymptote that we're looking for is not going to be x equals 1, so it makes sense that we didn't have any graph that matched, but we're actually looking for a vertical asymptote where does the denominator, which is just x equals 0, oh, it's just x equals 0. So it looks like we're choosing between options C and E. Those are the only graphs that have such a vertical asymptote, so let's ignore that at the top. All right, so how do I make the decision between C and E? Well, let's look at the horizontal asymptote now. So thinking about the big X test, as X becomes huge, this little plus 1 is going to get washed out. If X is like 50,000, 1 minus 50,000 over 50,000, it's these X terms that are taking the distance runner angle here. So at large X values, F of X is really behaving like negative X over X. They have equal power, so let's look at the simplified form of this. It's just negative 1. So between C and E, which one of those also has a horizontal asymptote that appears to be negative 1? Aha, it has to be graph E. Our horizontal asymptote is that negative 1. Y equals that negative 1. It is a horizontal line, but therefore our answer is graph E. All right, example 2. This is where we start to look at, okay, how can we set ourselves up for graphing? It's by just identifying asymptotes and intercepts. All right, and intercepts are just like we've seen in the past. Never mind. It just says holes in the graph. We'll get to intercepts later, I guess. So 24A, horizontal and vertical asymptotes, and B, holes in the graph. I'm going to do holes in the graph first. Remember, our first procedure should be to factor and simplify if at all possible. So let's see what we get here. I'm guessing there's supposed to be an X there, but it didn't print for some reason. I'm going to put these in standard form, negative 5x to the second, then the negative 14x, and then the positive 3. And in the denominator, we've got a 2x to the second, a positive 7x, and a positive 3. All right, so first of all, let's see if we can factor anything. I would opt to factor out a negative 1 from the numerator just to make the factoring easier if it is possible. And all that does is switch the signs on our terms inside. All right, so for the numerator, we get a negative 15. What multiplies to be negative 15 and adds up to positive 14? Well, that would be a negative 15 and a positive 15 and a negative 1. Multiplies and adds how we want. So I still got that negative 1 out front of my factors. I want to not lose sight of that. But I want to make a 15, so I'm going to take the 5 and the 3. I want to make a negative 1. Make sure it foils back, 5x squared plus 15x minus 1x minus 3. Okay, I feel good about that. Denominator, same thing, 2 times 3 is 6. What multiplies to be 6 and adds up to 7, it's 6 and 1. So I've got my 2x and a plus 3, and I've got an x and a plus 1. 2x squared plus 6 plus 1 plus 3, yep, it foils together the right way. Take a look at what we found out here. A factor canceled. So to answer letter B, there's a hole in the graph where x equals negative 3, the solution out of that canceled factor. And to find out the y coordinate of that, it's just going to show up as part of our graph, but as a hollow point. Let's distribute this negative 1 back into our numerator. Negative 5x plus 1 over 2x plus 1. That's our simplified f of x after we canceled out that hole in the graph. So if I plug negative 3 in here, my new f with a negative 3 plugged in, it's not going to give me 0 over 0 anymore. I get 15 plus 1 over negative 6 plus 1, 16 over negative 5, negative 16 fifths. And that's really useful, being able to find the full ordered pair. I don't know if the back of the book says there's a hole when x equals negative 3 and then just stops there, but it's well worth your time to just plug that x value back into your simplified function, because this is a piece of our graph. It's going to help us graph when we get to 2.7. You'll see that a little bit better. All right, so for letter A, now let's look for vertical and horizontal asymptotes. Vertical asymptotes are where the denominator equals 0, and we want to keep a heads up. We factored the denominator back here in green, but realize that x equaling negative 3 is not a vertical asymptote, so we want to be sure we're looking for the holes in the graph first. I don't want to think that there are two vertical asymptotes when really one of them came from a canceled factor. The only other x value that could zero out my denominator, or zero out my new denominator, I guess I could say, is x equaling negative 1/2. All right, for now the other asymptote, a horizontal asymptote they're asking for specifically, we're going to look at degree. This is a little bit easier if we look at the original function, just because we haven't factored anything. Those powers, those degrees, are a little bit more readily visible. And I noticed that, hey, numerator and denominator, they're both degree 2. We've got equal power here. The distance runners for both parts of the fraction are equally matched. So this is where we get the horizontal line at large x values. This function, all of these other minor terms are going to get washed out. It's the distance runners we're looking at. So this is going to act like a negative 5/2. The x squareds are perfectly matched with one another. Negative 5 over 2 is our horizontal asymptote. All right, and then to verify using a table of values, we would just want to see, hey, if I type this into the calculator, which is a chore in and of itself, that's a lot of stuff to type in, do I see the graph do that kind of zigzaggy type routine? This is my x, this is my y, where x equals negative 1/2. Am I seeing a horizontal asymptote where y equals negative 5 over 2? In the table, we would see when we go to like x values that are in the hundreds or thousands, will we be getting pretty close to negative 5/2. All right, this next example, here's where we tie into the intercepts a little bit. Find the zeros, if any, of the rational function. And I just noticed that 44, every once in a while, the equation editor, when I print to a PDF, will leave off. We already saw it with the x on the last problem. Let's take a look at what's missing here in 44. It is a plus 5. So I'm just going to add that in right now, since I got the book in front of me. We do not care at all about asymptotes on this one. We're not trying to make a graph. All we want to look for is zeros. So the zeros, we're going to go ahead and do the full algebra for 38 and then see if we could fast track it. So the zeros are where the output, the f of x equals 0. And in order to find out where this fraction equals 0, we'd probably want to get rid of the fraction, right? Let's multiply the denominator out of both sides. And hey, I'm multiplying by 0 over here. My equation is really, where does x to the third plus 8 equal 0? And so this one is, I don't know if that's assumed that you know that or not yet. This one's kind of a loaded question, and I'll get to the simple answer and then the more involved answer, because we know that a fraction is going to equal 0 wherever its numerator equals 0. That's essentially what leads us to this point in time. We back that up with a little algebra step up above. Now, a lot of you, I'm sure, would just subtract the 8 from both sides and say, hey, what undoes a third power? It's a third root on both sides. And hey, I am allowed to take an odd root of a negative number. The answer is just negative 2. And that's good, but there's actually two others, because remember, this is a third degree polynomial that we're trying to find the zeros for. So I'm only getting one solution when I should be getting three. There's a factoring technique called the sum or difference of perfect cubes, and it goes like this. If I have two things that are either added or subtracted, and those two things are both perfect cubes, then their factorization, the first factor is the exact same expression just without the third powers, and the second takes the first thing squared. We switch the sign, the first times the second, and then always plus the second thing squared. It's kind of a complicated factoring technique, but I'll demonstrate it here. So if we're finding, it didn't say find the real zeros. If it said find the real zeros, we're done. But how this technique would look here, x to the third plus 8 is really x to the third plus 2 to the third. So if I factor that out, I get x plus 2 times x squared minus 2 times x plus 2 squared. And so you can see coming out of that first factor, there's that negative 2. That's what we found algebraically. But those two hidden zeros, they will be imaginary. They come out of this, and we would find them using quadratic formula. X equals opposite of b plus or minus the square root b squared minus 4 times a times c all over 2a. X equals 2 plus or minus the square root of negative 12. It's imaginary. 12 is 2 root 3. So those other zeros are 1 plus or minus 1 I root 3. I am imagining, though, that seeing where we're headed with this, we're probably not too concerned with complex solutions or imaginary zeros coming out. It's a nice little talking point. You will not need this sum or difference factoring for your test in this or quiz over these sections or this chapter in this class. All right, so for 44, find the zeros. Again, the zeros or the x-intercepts are going to happen where the numerator equals 0. That will zero out the whole fraction. So I'm looking at where is the numerator equal to 0. Okay, now just to be sure that I don't get something showing up that's a hole in the graph, I'm going to go ahead and factor both parts. For the first one, I want a 10 and a 1. For the second one, let's see, we got negative 30 multiplying and a positive 13. That's a 15 and a negative 2. Aha, we did have a hole in the graph. So I don't even have to do this anymore, because now that I know that one of those factors canceled, I'm just trying to find out where does my new numerator equal zero. That was a close call. We almost got an extra solution that wasn't actually a zero. It was a hole in the graph. So zero equals 2x plus 1. That means x equals negative 1/2. So that is our only zero for number 44. Like I said, short section, but a lot of little mechanic things, and particularly being able to read that big X test. That is such a huge concept, just fully understanding a graph, and something that's going to help us out in the long run. Again, looking ahead to calculus big time. So to acclimate ourselves here, this is going to make for a much easier section 2.7. Be sure we're asking questions here. Find the patterns. Really sink some honest practice into this, just like you do every time, right? But this is going to really serve us well ahead. So here's a look at that assignment for you.